May 7th, 2022. Another busy day on planet Earth. First Lady Jill Biden visited Kyiv. Vladimir Putin was accused of another 10,000 war crimes in Ukraine. May 7th was noted as National Tourism Day by someone somewhere. COVID cases were back on the rise. National Hurricane Preparedness Day was declared, and Donald Trump continued to sulk in Mar-a-Lago. Meanwhile, in Gainesville, Florida, the weathered and battle-scarred survivors of the culture wars of the 60s and 70s gathered in force to celebrate the founding and operation of the landmark and bulwark of the future to come, the one and only Subterranean Circus, ground zero of the battle to bring Florida into modernity and to make thousands realize they were not alone. May 7th, 2022 was the day of the last tango in Gainesville, brought to us by the proprietor of the Subterranean Circus, Bill Colleen, and his coterie of happy malcontents and shit disturbers. Join us now to relive this happy day at Heartwood in the heart of Gainesville, a day of music and celebration.
My mom shot the hananias around. Because of my mom, shot the hananias around. Oh, the hananias. Oh,
I would say like about a little over 2 years ago when COVID got in the way, we probably would have had it a year sooner. I was talking with Chuck LeMasters and Leonard Weinbaum and some other friends, and I said, you know, I've got this money in the bank. My wife's fine. She's got plenty of money. I don't have any children. My two sisters are, you know, they're doing fine for themselves. Why let the money just sit in the bank? Let's do something. And the people who had contributed to my success were the people that are out there today. So why not spend some of the money to let them all get together one more time? Otherwise, they're never going to do it. I'm never going to see them. I mean, a little bit selfish because I would like to see them all again too. Yeah. And I said, let's create a real emotional maelstrom out there and get all these people back with old lovers, old wives, and so on and so forth. And get all the people who worked in the store that are still alive and can make it. Let's get them back too. So we prepared 18 months ahead of time so that it would come off as well as it is coming off out there. There's a lot of good feeling out there.
Yeah.
And it's, a lot of people, some of them don't know who I am, but they figure it out after a while.
Yeah.
And they come up and they thank you and they tell you what they remembered of those days. You come up talking to them, they got tears in their eyes. They're grabbing your arm like they love you, you know? I mean, who could want anything more than that? It's only $30,000. Come on. I'm going to buy a cheaper version of the Tesla. I'm going to have something like this go on. I'll take the party.
What would you think if I sang out a tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Bend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I can buy a little help from my friends. I can hire a little help from my friends. Oh, I'm going to try.
I really believe that those of us who grew up and were fortunate enough to be in the early 60s were in our adolescence at that time. The whole hippie thing to me was something that there's not never been anything like it, unlikely to ever be anything like it, because everybody was hopeful that they could actually change society, make it better.
We helped people turn on and understand that this plastic world they were living in was headed in the wrong direction.
Yes, I'm certain that it happens all the time. What do you see when you turn out the light? I can't tell you, but I know it's mine. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends. Oh, I can try with a little help from my friends.
It was all about the store. You wouldn't think a store that sold hippie junk could make that much of a dent or change the whole terrain of a town with just, you know, a few clothing items and contraband paraphernalia, but it did. Maybe it was because it was a hub. It was a place for the disaffected to find each other and compare notes. You have to remember the times. Everything was so buttoned down. It was Marcus Welby, M.D., Life with Father, Ozzie and Harriet, Amos and Andy were still on TV. Bill was the guy with the vision that started with a college humor magazine that would turn a town on its head.
The thing about the Charlatan was that we didn't have any restrictions.
Yeah.
So we could cuss out deans and university presidents and do whatever the heck we wanted to.
Centerfolds of beautiful naked co-eds and things like that.
That was a big deal because Pam Brewer was my girlfriend at the time.
That's why I brought it up.
She, we had a nude picture of a girl, which was not, in those days, it was just kind of a, you know, breasts and not much else.
Right. Yeah.
And so they threatened to throw her out of school. Well, the university had a rule called in loco parentis, which allowed them to act in place of the parent.
That's right.
Okay. So Pam said, my girlfriend said, well, I'll do it. And I really tried to talk her out of it because I knew her parents and, you know, I had been to her house. They tried to throw her out of school and there was a massive resistance to it. And the they had a trial in Tigard Hall, which is the administration building.
Really?
The trial, there were so many pissed off kids because that was the age where there was a lot of rebellion starting. They went in and they were pounding on the walls of the room that the trial was supposed to be
really?
Held in.
Wow.
Yeah. So they just moved the whole thing over to the law school auditorium, and there's like 3,000 people. I walked out of Tigard Hall that day, and Walter Cronkite was standing there with a microphone.
You are kidding.
He had three people there, the whole crew. Was on the news that night on his program. Was on the next night. Was on the night after that.
Wow.
Pam was getting mail in mail sacks like Santa Claus's bag. You should have seen some of the stuff. Envelope written in crayon, you know. Oh, you always have to worry when you get one in crayon.
Yeah.
Well, the ACLU paid for our lawyer, and he was a young Turk, you know, and he came in here. His name was Selig Golden, Jewish guy. He wiped the floor with him, you know. And so they gave up. They said, okay, we can't enforce this law anymore. Well, that was had a domino effect all across the country. Hmm. Universities stopped trying to enforce in loco parentis everywhere. So Pam really did that herself. I wasn't going to be able to do it with somebody else who would actually be the person. And she was very attractive.
Wow. Yeah, she was.
So, I mean, we had to do a reprint of the magazine. We had to do that again. Yeah. You know. From that, I actually was able to glean about $1,200, which is what I took up to New York to open the circus.
Really? So that was a
$1,200 worth of inventory.
Oh, good.
We moved in $5 a month building, which used to be a fertilizer warehouse.
Well, all of us, it started off, the atmosphere where I was at the time was very clear, the air was pure, there was quiet and peace and sensibility, and then, I don't know, I came and saw that blacklight room and ran into people that like blacklight stuff, and the next thing I know, the atmosphere was smoky and coughing.
Well, we would start every day off smoking. We'd just come in, roll a joint behind the counter, smoke it.
We would talk about you know, things were happening. You know, it was the place where you could go. And so, you know, I started letting my hair grow, and then I started smoking weed, and
it became a hub. I mean, when somebody would come to town and they want to know where Joe Schmo lives, so we knew where everybody lived.
It was just a great deal of fun. We just had so much fun there. It changed my life.
At that time, you have to understand, this was in the 60s. This is when they had an area in Gainesville called Hippie Town, and it blended in with what was going on at the time, the Vietnam War. We had protests at University and 13th Street in the middle of the night, and we'd had streakers running through Gainesville at night. Just crazy stuff. You know, with the university and the kids, it was the culture back then, and the Subterranean Circus was way ahead of its time.
We had to be extremely careful about drugs because the state's attorney was out there watching, you know.
Sure.
And that guy named, Eugene Whitworth, state's attorney. He a fanatic, you know.
Yeah, he gets reelected.
Binoculars, guys hiding in the bushes, the whole 9 yards. But as clean as the store was, the parking lot was like Coney Island. I mean, you had guys with the trunks open to the car going back and forth.
I would spell people that worked there, and Bill would come in, and he'd be like, "Hey, Ringer, what's up?" And so I'm like, "Is this okay?" He goes, "Yeah, man, anytime." So I literally lived there. I mean, I would, as soon as school's over, I'd go over and I'd hang out at the Subterranean Circus. And at some point, I rented a house a couple of doors down. So he was right, you know, that there wasn't any selling or anything going on there. It was, you know, a couple of doors.
Was under surveillance? Or?
We never allowed ourselves to think that. And surveillance wasn't as good at that time. And anybody that's really stoned, really an acid head, can pretty much see through anybody that's trying to come in and impersonate a hippie. It's hard to do unless you're there.
Florida had a paraphernalia law that was going to take place on such and such a date. So we encouraged everybody, and we didn't need to encourage them very much, to buy all the rolling papers and all kinds of stuff. If they ever wanted it again, get it now, okay? We made $7,000 that day in a little hedgehog. I had the biggest Halloween party you ever saw. Free beer. After that day, when everybody was coming in buying, you know, 50 boxes of club papers,
yeah,
and never going to see
5-year supply.
We just kept right on doing the same thing that we've been doing the whole thing. We just kept open. We kept, well, okay, let's have them bust us and see what happens, you know.
And how many times did you hear one, folks? I mean, doing the meetings.
Oh, boy, why you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all have Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime. No help from my friends. Oh, Lord, why you buy me a Mercedes?
Marty Girard has a website out west called Gainesville Rock History, which has like 3,500 members. And anytime the Subterranean Circus gets mentioned, they get like 250 to 300 comments on people's memories of the store. It's not something I would have thought was the case. You know, it's not, I'm not out there thinking, oh, I've got all these fans out there. You know, it didn't occur to me, you know. Right. But then I read Marty's thing and I see all these people, which virtually every one of them remember the Blacklight Room for some reason. I don't know what was going on back there. Maybe I need to check more often.
I came to college in fall of 69, or rather 66. And I didn't know, I was a little airhead. And I got to Gainesville, and the next thing I know, there were hippies and all that kind of stuff. And somebody said, oh, you got to go check out this Black Light Room at this place downtown. Okay.
Walked into the front area, you know, with the kind of had the underground comics up towards the front in the near the window. And then you had on your left as you came in the counter where you would check out. And there were a variety of racks and stands and things with the merchandise. And then all of a sudden you step into the back and here was this huge area with the all the black light and the fabulous posters, and as I mentioned, you know, that crazy wavy potato chip sculpture and other things. And so, you know, especially if you had you know, taken part, as it were, imbibed in a little of the old Gainesville green going in there, it was like going into a different world.
They were all weird. There were
the ones that we came in and forgot of, what they were there for.
I think that probably would.
I've got a list.
Yeah, exactly. could you tell me where? I don't know what I want, but I'm. Could you help me find it? Well, what do you want? I don't know.
I am possibly the one person that's most responsible for Bill Colleen's success. I think I figured out I bought about 30 packs of zigzags and a waterbed. That's why he laughed at me when he called me about this, and I said, I only got one question, Bill. I haven't talked to you in about 40 years. Is that waterbed still under warranty? I guess it wasn't, because he kept laughing.
I remember one time I was in the circus, and Debbie Brandt comes running out from next door, from Silver City, and she's yelling something, and I walk out. There's this woman running down the street with hangers in both hands, with dresses attached to them, you know, a whole bunch of them. oh God. So I started running after her, and I said, damn, she's fast. I better put the cigarette out. I was in art school with Pam Brewer, Bill's lady friend, and Pam, of course, was famous or infamous for her posing in the magazine. She suggested to Bill that I get a job there because I had worked in a clothing store, which I had done from Florida. But Bill also knew that I had spent a good bit of time in San Francisco in 67, and that was some of that time was spent at Langley Porter Neuropsychiatric Institute. So he was a little hesitant.
I said, Danny, are you crazy anymore? I said, you got to might as well come right out with a chair.
Right.
He said, he'd laugh. He said, no, Bill, I'm not crazy anymore. I'm all right. He said, I was crazy for a little while.
Not today.
Okay now. He says, besides, I'll be the best salesman you ever had. Well, he was. It wasn't even before. Ricky was a good salesman, but Danny, from day one, first day worked there, sold 50.
The reason I did that was they had no idea what they were doing. They just had piles of clothes. So I just, started folding them all, putting them into size order, and going back and forth and saying, well, try this. If this doesn't work, try this. And I was actually selling clothes. And it was like shooting
a lot
fish
of hippie type clothes,
yeah,
because they were coming out left and right,
sure,
with them.
Yeah.
Betsy Johnson back then, who became famous and still is, I guess, was running a company called Paraphernalia, or she was a main designer for a company called Paraphernalia. And so they were coming out with just alternate culture type clothing. And so we started buying some of that. And you remember when everybody was wearing Cossack and Nehru shirts and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah.
We went to New York and in the alphabet numbers, Avenue A, Avenue B, those kind of places. We were buying Cossack and Nehru shirts from people who were making them in their houses, and they could not make enough. So Pam hired 18 people to make Cossack and Nehru shirts. And and we sold as many as we could make.
Making them up there?
Making them here.
Here?
Yeah, we made them in the back of the circus.
Yeah.
Thank you. Petty was very slow and basically unrecognized in Gainesville and in Florida. And that's what makes it to me all the more amazing. He couldn't necessarily sing very well. He didn't, he wasn't writing amazing songs, but he was writing songs. And there he was. And I mean, the band I was in, we used to make fun of Mudcrutch. I was in a band called Road Turkey, and they would make fun of Road Turkey. It was just, you know, we were just doing the dirty dozens on each other.
Something on your mind you want to get off your chest?
I really wish I'd treated Tom Petty nicer when I knew him.
I've always regretted that moment.
I've always regretted that moment.
Well, I was just turning 18 from 17 then. And just a couple months later, we did another festival, and I spent a couple days with Timothy Leary and Osley Stanley. So those experiences really moved me, and I decided that my role was to promote the counterculture through bringing people together for music. So I moved to Gainesville and fell in with some people, and I was fortunate enough to do a lot of music here from 1970 to 76.
The 60s and 70s, I mean, that was what drove the whole society. You know, there's a great outpouring of music. In fact, this is what got me interested in rock and roll. I was raised on jazz, and I had to be dragged kicking and screaming into the rock and roll world.
The Florida Theater was built in 1939 as a movie theater, and I saw many movies there, and then it closed, and Jeffrey Meldon somehow hooked up and created the Great Southern Music Hall. And the Great Southern Music Hall, which used to be the Florida Theater, was converted into about a 300-seat concert venue. And he created this club where he could ask top acts if they wanted to play on a weekday between major gigs in major cities, and they were driving either to Florida or out of Florida, they could play on a Tuesday in he'd get a really good price, you know, they'd be willing to do it for less money on a Tuesday or a Wednesday in Gainesville on the way to Atlanta or wherever they were going to play a major show.
We did that show on the night that time changed for a real specific reason. They made a rule at the university that no event could last longer than 4 hours. And that's because we were doing the Halloween ball from 10 a.m. to sunrise, and they weren't having any more of that. So, and they knew they could do a football game in 4 hours. So we chose that night to do it. And then, so it got to be 2 o'clock, and the lady that ran everything like that at the university, the administrator, she comes up and she goes, "Well, Jeff, it's 2 o'clock, you gotta end the show." And I said, "Well, Miss Roberts, my watch says it's 1 o'clock." So she realized it was the night that time changed and just went berserk. So we argued for about 20 minutes, and then Tom Petty's up there with Mudcrutch, and they're just cranking, and the fans are screaming, and everybody's having a great time. And she pulled the plug. And the fans tore down the sound towers from the left side of the stage and set the right side of the stage on fire.
We'll be right back.
number of people out there. I don't know what it is right now. Court thinks it's about 1,000 people. It could be in the vicinity of 1,000 people. It's really difficult to tell. We've had a lot of people coming and going because you're 7 years old. They don't want to stay all day, you know, so they go home, take a nap, and come back.
Right.
But I really do appreciate everybody coming. It's great. It makes me feel good. It makes me feel like the expense and all the time and all the hassle and all the fighting with Jeff was worth it.
I don't know. So Gainesville's changed a lot in all these years, and looks like a lot of us have still survived. And I love it. It's a great little town. It's the first place I've ever lived more than 18 months at a stretch, and I'm staying here.
And you know, my journey there, although it started at the circus and went in some very strange directions, the way I own the mental center and the business I run today started with him teaching me how to run a business. So
it's I was there a fairly short while, but obviously we made an impression on one another, because 50 years later, here we are, and Bill and Siobhan have been out to see me in San Francisco or Sausalito.
Subterranean Circus Day in Gainesville?
Yeah, it's Subterranean Circus Day. The mayor just signed a proclamation.
Yeah.
And so it really is ironic, because here they are,
yeah,
trying to close us down, put us out of business,
right,
arrest us for years, and now yeah, it's like we're heroes.
You're heroes, yeah.
You know?
It's kind of like, you know, you give it enough time and something that was viewed as bad, the times change.
The pendulum.
And it becomes suddenly the greatest thing, you know. So.
Well, that's what happened with the general public. I mean, hippies were idiots as far as they were concerned at
yeah,
first.
Right.
A few years later, they're all out buying the same
yeah,
clothes.
Yeah, right.
They're listening to the same music.
Right.
They're buying water beds.
That's right.
And they're wearing bell bottoms.
Well, I think it had more to do with Bill having the charlatan and just supporting all the rest of us that were doing activist stuff, which was anything we could do to, fight against a man. You know, we wanted it our way. We knew we were right, and that's what we did. And we didn't pay attention to people telling us no. Every time I wanted to do a rock concert, every single one, I did 100 of them here. Every single one they told me no, I couldn't do, I did them anyway. So that's what we did. We did what we knew what was right and what people wanted.
Bill was driven.
Driven.
Yeah, I mean, whatever he put his mind to, he was going to try to do his best to succeed at it. If it didn't work, it didn't work, but he gave it his all.
The light that's lost within us reaches the sky. Some of them were angry at the way the earth was abused by the man.
Bill's party to celebrate the Subterranean Circus reunion, the last tango in Gainesville, was incredibly special. I mean, there were just reunions happening every minute. You just kept seeing people scream and hug each other and just start talking. They hadn't seen each other for 15, 20, 30, maybe more years.
No, I really thank Bill for allowing me to produce this show for him. For me, it's kind of full circle. I came back to Gainesville to try and open a rock and roll history museum for all the things we did back then. I was fortunate enough to give Tom Petty his foot up by taking him out of the bars and doing these shows with him on campus. I did them 30 times in concerts at Mudcrutch. And so I appreciate him letting me do this show, because for me, it's a real throwback. And kind of, you know, I wanted to promote the counterculture through bringing together people for music. So with this show, I'd say it's, job done. I'm complete now. So
the moment called for a lone cowboy to mosey out with his guitar and slowly wail the paean to old friends and memories. Tom Shedd did that perfectly in precisely the voice and manner that it needed to be done. By the song's end, the people around me were mostly standing, teary-eyed and emotional, some rooted to the ground, reflective and sated by the experience. And so was I, because at the end of the day, brothers and sisters, all of us are that lone cowboy.
And may you be in heaven a half an hour before the devil knows you're dead.
Happy trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then. Who cares about the clouds when we're together?
Just sing a song and bring the sunny weather.
Happy trails.